administrative study in today's tutorial we'll be exploring Ubuntu or Linux. The major difference between Ubuntu and Linux is Linux is only command line interface, whereas Ubuntu provides some graphical user interface with few apps which can be used to go through in a graphical interface format. In this tutorial we'll be looking at various commands which are provided by Ubuntu or Linux to perform various operations. A prerequisite for this video would be that you have an operating system to work on so that you can practice it. Because the more you practice it, the more hands-on you get on with it, the more easy and familiar it will be for you. After seeing this video, you can add up Linux or Ubuntu in your resume as well, because once you know these commands, no organization will expect you to know more than this at a fresher level or even at an experience level, because these are all the commands which are used by any organization or any project in day-to-day activities. So let's begin with the first command, which is cd. So I will be even comparing these commands with how we perform the actions in Windows system, okay? So first command is cd, which stands for change directory. What does this mean? Now if you remember, in Windows we go into C drive or D drive and then we move to some X folder, and inside that some X folder we have some path. So once we get into, now if you have a file in some C drive, some X folders, F folders, Z folder, you cannot directly access the file without going in the path which it is stored in. Similarly, here also any file you download or store will have a path. So to get into that path, we use cd command. So once you type cd, the next step would be give the path directly, the location where you want to shift. So cd, for now let's go with slash. Slash is the root directory. See, remember root directory, what is root directory, how things work, we'll be looking at in detail in this video. So root directory is nothing but in Windows you can call as an administrator, who has all the access and all the files are stored in that thing. So root is the operating system from the operating system level, from where all the directories begin, and whatever files are stored all comes inside this root directory. So anything you have in Linux operating system will be coming under this root directory. So once you type root slash, next thing would be the folder name. There are many default folders like etc, opt. Let's go with etc. One more shortcut, let me even keep saying you the shortcut. Once you type slash ee, and if you click on tab, whatever is the suggestion, because in this slash etc, after slash there is only one folder with etc which starts with e, so it directly changes the path to e. So let's just click enter and see whether the path changes. You can see here we are in the slash etc folder. Similarly, using cd you can shift to any location you want. And suppose if you want to look, like suppose you type slash cd and you don't know what all files or folders exist and what are the names of them, you can just type the starting letter of something if you know and just type tab. If there is some file with such folder, it will just display you. I'll just see. To list what all the files are available, I just will look into this ls command in little later time. Suppose we have something like fonts. So there's a directory called fonts. So now let's see how will we get into this directory. So we type slash cd slash f o fonts. So One thing you might have observed, when I just type F and click on tab, there's nothing happening. Why? Because there are multiple folders which start with ls, which start with F, which is Firefox font. So they here FWPD. So when you have more than one thing starting with a single letter, the automatic suggestion won't work. So that time you need to type one more letter. In this case, it will be something like FO, and then you type tab, it goes into that folder. Now this is about getting into a folder or directory where you want to get into. Suppose you want to come one step back. Only thing you need to do is go with CD, which is change directory. If you type double dot, it will just come one step back. You can see here, it is still in etc. But suppose, let's go into fonts again, and we just type CD and do not type anything. It will directly come to the root or desktop level, whichever is the default location of the terminal. It will come there directly by just typing CD wherever you are in the. And one more thing, suppose I am in the fonts, suppose let's shift into fonts, and suppose now I want to shift to some other directory, I need not come back using CD and then enter into other directory. I can just directly type slash, and you can type something. There's one more folder called opt. You can directly get into that folder and check out things, whatever you want. So this is about change directory. Now let's come back, and now let's see. You can use up arrow to go to your previous commands which you have already executed or typed in the terminal, which will be coming as you keep on pressing up arrow. So there is no rework required here. That is one more advantage here. So you can see now we are at the root. Now suppose we want to create some new folder or something with some build upon our requirement. You want to create a new folder. So the command would go like this. mkdir, which stands for make directory. See, all the commands, if you try to understand, they have a meaning with it, which will help you to easily remember them. So if you want to make a directory, what will it be? mkdir. Simply make directory, give some name. Let us suppose for this example, let's use abc. Let's see what happens. Yeah, let's get into permissions. So you might have got this thing. As I said you in the beginning itself, like in Windows, here also we have administrator access as well as root user access. So to perform anything where we want to create some folder or manipulate some folder or some file, we need root user permissions. So let's first see what is root user. How do we make our terminal as a root user? So to make our terminal as a root user, nothing you need to do is just sudo sudo, which is a standard command wherever you are in the terminal. Just type sudo and then you can directly type the command name, which is mkdir and abc. This, what it does is, it will ask you a password, whichever you have set for your system. And once you enter the password, so once you type the correct password, it will create a file for you. So see, here I typed the password and there's no error being shown. It means there's a folder with ABC name created. Now how do we check whether a folder is created or not? So remember, when you want to list some files in your directory, you can directly type ls. Ls means list. See, you can see it is like, you know, it is easy to remember them if you try to understand what the command is used for. And it comes for ls, it means lists. So if you directly type ls and Center, it will directly display you the list of folders which are available, and you can see there's a folder with name ABC. So let's get into the folder by typing CD A and tab, and it will directly select. If there are multiple folders with same letter beginning, you need to supply one more letter which is like unique enough in the whole folder, so that the system can directly shift to that folder. Now let's check if something else is there in this, and you can see there's nothing inside this because we have just created an empty folder. So this was about creating folder. Now you can even create folder under a folder. Let's see how we can do same thing, like mkdir sudo mkdir. Let's give the whole, actually whole structure is not required here because we have already shifted to this folder. Else if you are in the root or some other location, you can give slash abc slash whatever name you want to give. Let's go with xyz and see what happens. And let's just list now. See, you can see xyz is existing inside this. So now let's get back to the root level wherever we were. Now we created these two folders and we want to delete this. How do we do that? See, for make directory it was mk, for removing a directory it would be rmdir. So again it requires sudo permissions, so it's better if you use sudo whenever you feel there's some operation required which requires administrator access to change your operating system files and folders. You can use sudo as mentioned, and then type rmdir slash abc. See, you can find that here it is showing that it is not an empty directory. So what does it mean? Can't we delete a directory which is not empty? We can absolutely delete it, but for that you need to add one more thing, which will be hyphen f, so that it will be something like force remove. So once you click, it is showing an invalid option, but you can even do one thing like, first you can remove slash abc slash xyz and then remove slash abc. Now let's check if this is existing. You can see there is no such folder now. So this was about just creating a folder and deleting it. Once you have folder under a folder, you need to first delete the inside folder and then come back and delete this folder or whatever files are there inside the folder. Now let's clear the console for now. See, as you can see, this is case sensitive. I just typed capital AR here and it said that command is not found, which means that it is case sensitive. You need to remember this because it happens many times that we use both uppercase and lowercase letters and we get many errors. So always remember, Linux is always case sensitive in whatever password you type or whatever you store in your operating system, everything is case sensitive. Let's type clear and the console is cleared. Now suppose that we have many operations where we require sudo, in the sense administrator access. So every time typing sudo command name is like little lengthy process, I guess, right? So, is there any option where we need not type sudo each and every time? Yes, there is an option. You can just give administrator access at a time using sudo space su. What it does is, it makes the user as root user directly. So, whatever operations you perform inside this will be considered as administrator access permissions. So there's no need to type sudo in each and every command which you give. Now let's come to present working directory. What does this mean? Present working directory is you are like currently located in. Let me give you Windows example. Suppose you are in some folder in D drive A, and there's a folder called Z, and there's some folder called X, and there's a folder called K, and there's some big directory structure. So you are confused, like where am I? So you can use, first of all, you can use PWD to check the present working directory. Currently we are in slash home slash Radha. Now let's change the directory slash etc. And let's check the PWD command. You can see it is showing slash etc. So when you type PWD, it shows the current working directory, current location of the user, where the user is working and where the file or folder is being stored. It is always important to remember the location where your files are stored, because you cannot directly access them without knowing the location of them. So this was about present working directory. Now if you want to know which kind of user am I, like whether I'm a root user, whether I'm some created user, who am I, like whichever location you want to know. So there's a simple command called who am I. Once you type this, it will let you know whether you are a root user or you are a non-root user. And as I said to you, root user means you have all the right administrative access which is required to perform any action throughout the system without any restriction. Okay. Now let's see one more command called touch. What is touch? touch. Now suppose you want to create some file, or you want to text file. File in the sense some text file where you want to store some information, whatever, like anything. Let it be built upon your business requirement or company's requirement. You can just type touch space file name. Let's give file name as abc.txt. Let's see what happens. And let's check whether a file with ABC is created. See, one second. Just I'm guessing. Let me clear this console. To create a file, there are various editors available within the Linux operating system. The most commonly used editor is vim editor or vi editor, which directly allows you to type, edit any text within the folder, within the console, or within the terminal itself. And remember that suppose you type vi space abc dot txt and you put enter, it opens up file. So in this you can type anything, and before typing, remember there's a option or key called insert on your keyboard. You need to type it. Once you type it, you are allowed to type in anything inside this. Like suppose let me type hi, hello, world. This is my first file. Okay, and you can type anything, number, anything, it doesn't matter. And to save the file, just click on escape and then type shift colon and WQ. You can see in the bottom of the screen it has been written shift colon WQ. So shift colon in the sense colon, it is nothing but shift colon WQ. Not shift, escape colon WQ. So once you type this, what does it mean? Here we have many options again. Here it is WQ. We even have Q, which means quit without saving. WQ means save and quit. quit the file in the sense come back to the terminal from wherever we started with. So let's click enter and see what happens. Now let's type touch ABC. Same thing happens. Now once you open the VA folder, you can see that. Now one more thing, let's type few text inside this so that this would be helpful for other commands. So let's type something in order so that it will be easy to recognize what is coming up and what is not coming up. Okay, we have more than 10, I guess. Okay, it's enough for this tutorial and let's save it. See, when we are typing WQ, the other options available are forced WQ. Forced WQ means sometimes it happens that file do not allow you or do not give you access to edit them. Then you can type force exit. To force exit any file, only thing you need to do is once you open the file and click on escape colon WQ exclamatory mark, which means force. Exclamatory mark indicates that you need to force the action irrespective of user's choice. So this will force. Now if you want to quit the file, like I said, without saving, you can just use. Now let's try it again. Okay, I make some changes in this. I type something like, but I don't want this to be saved. What to be done? Escape colon Q. See, it's not giving permission. It's escape colon Q. And it's back. Now let's open the file and see. See, you might have seen the 1, 2, 3, whatever numbers you typed, it has not been saved. This happened because we used just quit command, which is Q. So similarly, we have many other things like force quit, force exit. So these are dealt with text editors. VIM is one editor. And instead of VI, you can even use VIM. Both does the same thing. But only thing requirement for VIM is you need it to be installed. You can say that it's a kind of editor which needs to be enabled in your system so that you can access it. Without being installed, you cannot access it directly. But VI is the default editor in any Linux operating system. Next command, let's see, will be man. What is man command? Man command is very important in this because any command which we use in the Linux operating system and we don't know what does the command does. Suppose I don't know what does pwd does. Now how do I know whether what all options can I pass through, what all parameters can I pass through, what all actions can it do? Only thing I need to do is type man space pwd and see. You have the name of command, what does it does, what is the description of the command, like prints the full name of the current working directory. Now what all parameters can be passed, and this is about the commands, like if you have any bug you can report them. These are about commands of the Linux operating system. So this is not just about pwd. Let's check for ls. Ls, remember, right in the beginning we saw for listing the files. So this is list directory contents. You can see it is mentioning list directory contents, description, list information about the files, the current directory. The current directory is by default, like I said, stores entries alphabetically if not off. So it means like it gives you what all options can be fired, like whether you want to list all the files. Hyphen capital A will be something like almost all. Hyphen hyphen author would be, it would print the author in each, like separately. So these are different options available and you can try to explore each and every of them. We are not looking in that detail in this video. It is not required also for now. For interview purposes, if you are seeing, or for any kind of organizational use, remember you just need to know the concept of what and how it happens. Once you know the concept, you need to just search it in Google, implement it by seeing what is happening, how the changes are made, make changes according to your requirement and just execute it. So you need not remember each and everything. The next command we'll look at is ping. What is P-I-N-G? See, ping is nothing. If you want to remember in some easier manner, pinging is like pinging your friend on mobile or something. So what does it mean? Like sending some kind of message or call or something. But in this case, ping is you give an IP address or a server address and you check whether you are getting a response from that address or not. And remember, if you give some address which is a web server or something like google.com, so you need to have an internet connection enabled so that it can reach out to google.com and check whether it is able to receive packets or not. We are not going into the networking details of it, but just to check whether particular server or particular application is running or not. Whatever application will be we run, it will have some port, it will have some localhost colon some port, some kind of address. So anything can be directly checked by typing. For now, let's check with google.com because this is directly easy to check, instead of check, so that you can also check it in your system. And you can see it is receiving some packets within some given time period. So what does it mean? Now let's type some false name which actually does not exist. Let me type some XYZ name and just type .com. See, name or service host not known. What does it mean? Did not receive any packet, or no packet was sent to them, or it could not reach them, so it does not exist. So within seconds you can figure out whether your application is running or not, whether it is receiving packets, it is receiving any data which is sent to it or not, by using the ping command. So this is also very important. Remember, all these commands you need to just practice. Once you get these commands, what is happening, how it is happening, once you practice in interview, they will not go in detail of this command because nobody actually remembers. Everybody just Googles and uses it. So next command which we use in day-to-day life will be copy command. So let's come to the root directory. Let's clear everything. And as you can see, there's only one snap folder there. So let's create some text file here, right? So as you remember, I would say without seeing here, directly create a text file. And once you create a text file, let me create a text file, something with abc.txt. Sorry, it was a typo error. Okay, as you have seen, vim is not available, to vi. And in this we type something like, to insert, you need to press the insert icon as I said you. Hi, this is my second file. Okay. File. And let's just save it without any much. Now we need to make one more copy of this. For now, you might be wondering, like, just for a single file, why can't you create it by just typing? But suppose, imagine we have some 10,000 lines or some 50,000 lines within the text file. You cannot keep on selecting the whole document or copying or typing it. So you can directly use the command which is cp. Cp means copy. The file you want to copy, which will be abc.txt, and the file in which you want to copy. Suppose if the file does not exist, the editor would create a new file and store all the details inside it. Let's create xyz.txt and let's click enter and let's check whether the file is created. There's a file called xyz.txt. Now let's check what are the contents inside this by just typing vi space xyz.txt. And you can see it is also showing this is my second file, although this is a third file, but it has just copied all the contents of second file into this. And remember, these both are individual files. Whatever you save or edit inside a single file does not directly replicate into the second file, it's just a copy of it. Now suppose like check the present working directory, it is root slash something. Now we want to copy this file to some other location. So how do we do that? We just need mv space abc slash txt and to where you want to copy to slash etc. Okay, let's copy to etc and check whether it is there or not. Okay. Now let's move to etc and let's type vi space abc dot txt and here is your second file. So this was about moving a file from one location to another location. Suppose we want to rename the file, again it would be same thing, which is mv space abc to something like, let's rename to this xyz.txt. Okay, now let's check whether abc.txt is available. See, this is actually bigger based, so let's just try to open if abc.txt is open. But I've seen once I opened it, created a new file without any information, although the information was there. Why is the information gone? Because we have renamed the file using the mv command. This has created again a new file. So as I said in the beginning, when you use vi editor, if the file already exists, it opens up the file. If it does not exist, it will create a new file and then open up. Now let's see xyz, what have we renamed to? Let us check xyz, right? Let's open xyz.txt and see this is your second file, and remember this is inside the root location slash etc slash this location. So this is not the file which I have created. Let's go back to cd and here you might be seeing xyz.txt because we have moved the abc.txt to slash etc. So both the contents are different, both the files are completely different. Now suppose you want to view the contents of the file between the terminal, and suppose you have some 50,000 lines or some 1,00,000 lines and you want to view only the first 10 lines or the first last 10 lines, then you cannot just go and manually go and read first 10 lines. So what would be the option is type tail. Tail means bottom last 10 lines file. ABC, the ABC file is existing inside the slash etc folder. So let's go with XYZ here for now. You can see this is my second file. What does it mean? Now to understand this more clearly, what you need to do is, like I said, you need to have a file which has more than 10 or 15 lines. Then you can choose slash. Then what it does is, once you have more than 10 lines, it will just display the last 10 lines in the tail command. So tail slash etc slash abc, there is no such file because we have renamed many files. So let us do one thing, let's just enter into this file and let's add up few things and see how things work out. So let's enter something like 2, 3, 4, 5. This is just for your clarity sake, to check what files, what folders are being like. Once you have more than 10 lines, it is easy to understand in a much easier manner. Let's go with 13, 14, 15 lines. Okay, now let's see what happens with tail command. Now let's give tail, and it is just displaying this. Okay, it was taking the slash etc slash. Let's go with instead of slash etc, just xyz.txt. And you can see it is just displaying 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Only the last 10 lines taking the first line. Suppose this was about last 10, because last 10, see, it is easy to understand last 10 is because 15, 14, 13, you can understand from when you come from 15, it goes up to 5. So, same thing is happening here. So it's coming in reverse order here. Suppose you want to know the first 10 lines of the file. Only thing you need to do is, instead of tail, give head xyz.txt, and you see you are just getting the first 10 lines of the file. So this was about head and tail commands. These are also like commonly used commands in our day-to-day activities. Now let's come to chmod. What is chmod? Chmod is when you want to change some file permissions. See, again, as I said, your file permissions are different from user permissions. You need to understand this concept. User permissions are whether he is a root user or not. Only the root user has all the access to the various commands or various, like, which are not directly given to any other user except root. But when it comes to file permissions, permissions are whether the file is readable or can it be editable, which is write, or is it executable also, like whether the user can execute the file. These permissions can be given to any file using root user access. Or suppose a file has a user access with some X name, so that user is allowed to give the access to that file. Let's look at this with the help of an example. Like, you might be seeing there is a file here already existing, xyz.txt, and we need to check, we need to give permissions to this. So we need to write chmod, which is change user permission. Chmod means change modification of the file, which means give him the access, give him the permissions which is mentioned in this command. So give the file name, and then now it comes like what kind of permissions you want to give. There are various ways in which you can give the permissions. Right now we are using number format to give the permissions. Remember, 4 means read. Please write it down and remember it. 4 means read, 2 means write, 1 means execute, 0 means no permission given to this user or this file, for this file, and 7 means give all the access to this user. Again, now these numbers should be mentioned in 3 formats: root user, group user, as well as level user. So here we'll be giving 777. If I give, it means here it is showing invalid mode for this thing. So the only error we made here was, instead of typing chmod xyz, first we need to give what kind of permissions need to be given, that is read write access. So remember, as I said, first thing will be group file owner read or write permissions, then it will be group permissions, and then it will be other user permissions. So whether you want to give all the permission read write access, then give 7. If you want to give only read write, then give some other number, like I said, you 4 is used for operations which are related with just save. Now let me say you in detail so that you will understand it in a proper manner. When I say you give 4, it means it will the group, suppose here I give 7 and I give 4 and then 7. What does this mean? It means that the user will have all the permissions, the group will have only read permissions because it is 4 in the read in the group place, and then other users will have all the permissions. It is actually not desirable, but just to explain you, I am saying this. And suppose you want to give only write permissions, you can use 2. Suppose you want to give only execute permissions, you can give 1. There are cases where we allow some third party to write the folder and some other testing team needs to just execute the file, then you can give permission like 1. It can only execute the file without any making any modifications to the file. And again, we have one more option, which is 0. 0 means there is no permission given to this file. So for now, let's go with 777, which means you are giving all read write access to all the users, and just click enter and you saw that all the permissions have been given to the file. So remember that whenever you are executing any kind of operation in your operating system and you face an error which says with something like you do not have permissions, so go to the folder or file where the file is existing and just type chmod and give the permissions which you want to give and give the file name. And remember, you need to have sudo user access to perform this action. And once you give all the permissions, or if you want to restrict a user, you can even restrict it using this. So this was about chmod command. Next, let's see what all. There's one more command called kill. What does kill mean? Suppose we have some list of processes running and we have some application except application running, and the application is not stopping how much ever we try to stop, then we can use this kill command to directly stop in the sense terminate the application directly with root user access so that it will be directly stopped. I'll just show you how this can be done. So first let us see what all are the processes or application running in our system right now, which can be done directly using ps command. Once you type ps space enter, you can see different process IDs and different operations or different applications which have been running here. Suppose let me run some textpad and let's run some 2-3 textpads. It's not opening up. Let's open this and now let's come back and type ps. Need to see whether if you need to. Sometimes what it happens is it does not display all the running applications. So you can use this ps aux command to display everything in detail, and you can see that what all are the applications been running. And let me see where is the see what all commands I'm running, everything is being recorded here. So you can directly stop it using the process ID which is here given here, or you can even use the process the port number. So what it does is, well, right now we are not having any application running. What you can do is you can run some application like Skype. Let me run Skype and let us see if it is displayed here. Let Let us wait for Skype to open. If it opens up, yeah, it is opening up. So, no, Skype has opened up. Let me check here. Yes, ops. It should show me Skype. Actually, this is a big list, so let me search. Let me search in a smaller way. So in this we are running some application. Let us suppose this sudo, the terminal is itself the application which we want to close, and we are trying to close manually and it's not getting closed, or there's some error happening. So you can directly close this application with kill command. Only thing you need to do is give kill process ID. Process ID will be 6192, let us suppose, and it's killed. Now let's see PS. 6192 is existing. Actually, it is a sudo command. Let me close the bash. Bash in the sense terminal. So it would be 6282 in my case. 6282. And let me see. So let's use kill hyphen 9, which will be like forcefully kill this process. So once I killed it, it came out of the application. Now let's use ps command and see. Now you can see there are only three or four things: pager, ps, man, bash. 1, 3, 4 things running here. So it means hyphen 9 is used to forcefully kill any application. So remember, any application which is running in our system will have a process ID associated with it. So once you use kill hyphen 9 and give the process ID or port number, it will directly kill the application. Kill in the sense stop it. Now next command let's look at is different, DIFF. What is this command? Okay, let me get back again to sudo su. Remember, the more you practice along with me, once you are done with the video, I will recommend you to watch the video once again and practice along with the video at least 3 to 4 times, so that you get habituated. Before, once I am saying that I'm going to do something, before I do, you just stop the video and do it yourself, so that any error you make it, you can again come back, check the video and do it again. So the more you practice, the more convenient you'll be with this video or with the Linux, whatever you call it. So next thing we'll be going at is DIFF. Let's see whether we have this text file here or not. So let's go to slash etc. Okay, let's create a new folder, cd space document. Let's move to cd space desktop. So I'm moving here directly. Let's create a mkdir. Let's create a folder with some example folder. Cd space example. Once we are into it, let's create two files with name dir space a.txt, and here we type 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and we type something, some random values, and let's just save this. And let's create a copy of this. Let's take it is .txt. Let's check whether we have two files here. But only thing you need to do is you need to add some extra contents inside any one of the file which you wish. Let's go with the first file itself, and let's add up few other things like
This is my file. Welcome to Linux tutorial. So this is just to understand the difference in the command which we are going to use now. So we have two files ready. Next thing will be, now we have, suppose we have a business requirement where we want to understand the differences between two files. Where is the difference? What is, like, we have two similar files and we want to understand where the changes is, like, differing. We can, instead of manually sitting and reviewing both the files by opening simultaneously, you can just type diff and then type z.txt and then next one is a.txt. Just see, once you type see, in both the files everything is same, except that you remember that in last I typed few random commands as well as hi this is my file and this. So except this, everything is same in both of the files. So what do you understand with this is, like, when you have multiple files to compare with, you can directly use this difference command and directly give the file names and check out what is happening. Next, suppose in Windows we have something called zipped files. Zipped file, in the sense they have been compressed, and like you can see in this example, I have already a file with is/linux/tar.gz. Usually this is the extension which is used to save the zipped files in Linux. So if you consider any application which you want to download for Linux operating system, once you get into their website and save the download the file, it would be in this format. And to open it, you can directly use tar, tar space hyphen cvzf. This is a thing which you need to give, and then give the file name, which is here in the case IE something, IES4. Okay, we are in the example folder, so it's not showing up. Let's come back to this thing and let's go to cd. Let's check what all are the files here. Okay, cd space slash home slash no, we have this folder, right? Now let's go with the command. So remember, the command is tar, in the sense the file extension is a zip file. And you need to give cvzf and the file name, which would be something like IE in my case. And once you click on enter, I am not going to click on enter, but let's check it. Once I click on enter, I am getting an error here because I don't know what kind of file that is and whether there's some content existing or not. But once you type in your system, you can directly execute and you can extract all the files to this present directly wherever you are logged into. And you have one more option with this. There are multiple options which you can just explore with Google. There's one more option called tar-xf, and you can use the same file. And it is going to depends on, like, what you are trying to recover, what you are trying to extract. For you need to, you know, test each and everything, and sometimes some command might not be suitable for a particular file. For some folders it might be directly suitable. So you need to figure out this. For your example, I would suggest that you download some Apache file or something. Apache is some application like Spring Boot application or Linux or not Linux, Eclipse application. And then once the file is downloaded, you can just try. Now in this case, there's one more command, tar space xvzf, and we give the same thing, again it's giving error. Maybe it might be problem with this file itself. If not, you might try in your system, you'll get all the contents extracted to the location. And suppose that you have downloaded some file in some downloaded folder and you want to extract in some other location, only change you have to make is, after giving this, give the folder or path where you want to, suppose /etc/so-and-so/so-and-so. So whatever path you give, the whole folder or the whole contents of the zip file will be extracted to that folder. Now let's look at another command. Let's clear the console. To clear the console, you can just use clear, C-L-E-A-R. Now another command is history. History is used to check different kinds of commands which you have used previously. See, right now I just tried to use xvzf, xf, cvzf. So you might be wondering why is it showing only these commands and why not others. So it, whatever is stored in the cache after shutting the system, all the things have been shown here. And it tries to keep the history of commands which you have kept executing throughout the cycle. So next command would be, suppose you want to shut down the system from terminal, you can use, I will not be shutting down right now, but just to show you, if you want you can try it in the last. Okay, shut down and you click enter and the whole system, all the application gets closed and it just shuts down. Instead of going and manually shutting down, you can just type shut down and the whole system is off. You can even schedule your shutdown by typing shutdown space what time you want to shut down and give some message you want to display to the user. Suppose I type shutdown something around 00:11, which means 12:11 a.m. and you give some message, hi it's late, we are closing. So once you type this or once you give this command, what it does is it will give you a 15 minutes reminder that it is better that you close all your applications, save all your data, because the system is going to be shut down within 15 minutes. So this is especially useful in organizations where you want the employee to close his work after a specific time. So this can be done. One more interesting command with this is reboot. Once you type reboot, I won't be typing this because the whole video will be collapsed because of that command, because it will directly restart your system directly without checking anything and it will terminate all the running files and folders. One more interesting command which you would love to know is YouTube hyphen DL hyphen hyphen list hyphen format space, you can give some video link. And what does this command does is it will directly download your YouTube video into the current directory wherever you are in. Or you can, even after giving the link, and you can give the space and directory where you want to store the folder. So instead of using some third party application to download your YouTube videos, you can directly use this command and it is so handy. And remember guys, once you start using Linux, you will feel it is the best operating system because it is so easy to perform any kind of action just from terminal. Now in Windows you have to, now suppose you want to schedule a shutdown, you have to pick so many icons, go to so and so folder, open so and so application, schedule a timer. Here it's just a matter of commands, and once you start practicing them, once you start remembering them, suppose you take copy, you have to, in Windows you want to copy into some
suppose there's some 10 folders and between the D drive, and you need to open each and every folder, go there, copy and come back to the location where you want to save. Such a hectic process. Here just you can do is cp space slash whatever is the location, keep going by entering the tab, by entering the digits in this is file name or folder name and tab. It will keep giving you suggestions based on the file name, and you click enter and everything is done without any headache, So this is why Linux is more preferred, and more advantage with Linux is you do not need to have any antivirus or anything, because it is 100% protected, and there is almost least chance of virus getting affected compared to Windows. So that is about Linux, guys. Thanks for watching this video. I hope this was helpful, and remember, for any interview process, they won't be expecting you to know more than this one. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe this video. If you have any doubts, please put in the comment section and we'll get back to you. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much.